Welcome to another edition of I Remember Bedford, and who remembers Bedford better than our official town historian, John Dodge. Welcome back, John.
Well, glad to be here.
Great.
So glad to relate all these pictures and articles I've saved over the years.
Mm-hmm.
And also I married Connie Donovan, who had been collecting old things of Bedford. So what I'm going to do is, most any day now, is donate the collection to the Historical Society. And I've made Xerox copies of things to be looked at rather than store away in a cabinet someplace, no one's seeing it.
Great.
So I have a lot of quite interesting things. In fact,
and you brought several things with you today to show.
I just brought some things to show. And right here, as I read off part of it, this is from the 1927 town report. We have a great problem. Too much traffic through the center of town. We need additional police. That's 1927, we had a problem with traffic.
So what happened
years ago is before Route 3, so people from Allenton, of Cambridge, were going to go to the White Mountains,
mm-hmm.
many of them carried through Bedford.
Oh.
So on a Sunday in Bedford, there's a steady line of cars all the way. We didn't even have a traffic light in town those days, too.
Feeling the pinch of all that extra traffic, even back then.
We think it's
bad now.
So I have a lot of great memories of this town. It's a great town. I'm so fortunate. I've been here since I was 2 years old.
Mm-hmm.
That makes me almost living in this town 90 years.
Yes, I've seen
the changes from being a farm town, which I gave a talk last time about farms. And now I'm going to be a little eclectic and talk about a little bit of everything about this town. I talked about the Grange Fair before. Well, the Grange Fair was held in the Bedford House. And I have a photograph of the Bedford House with a livery back here. And there's an ad in a Bedford little magazine that I put out for years ago. It cost $2 a night to stay at the Bedford House.
Mm-hmm.
Big deal. And that's where they had the Grange Fair all the time.
Yes, and the Bedford House used to stand where the fire station is now.
That's right, that's right.
Unfortunately, they knocked it down.
Yeah.
It was quite the showplace.
And then I remember this old house in Bedford. It was off Elm Street, down near the end of it. And that was where Stagecoach stopped. And I found this article in the Boston paper, in a little magazine section, tells how the Stagecoach stopped in Bedford on the way to the White Mountains.
In between Boston and the White Mountains, right through Bedford.
Really aren't in a sequence here, but jumping back and forth, but I do have a lot of interesting things. This is the way I used to go swimming as a little boy.
Yeah,
we had a name for it, BAB, but I won't mention it this time. I think I've told the story about the beach before.
It was a clothing optional beach, wasn't it,
that's
John?
That's right, yeah.
And this is a wide part of Elm Brook.
That's right.
Off of Hartwell Road, isn't it?
That's down off the Hartwell Road.
Yes. Yeah. A boys' beach.
Boys' beach. Then I have here, it's a 1927 baseball team. It's from Bedford.
They're in Bedford, and they all have uniforms that say Bedford on them.
That's right, yeah. And I know the last Arthur Giannetti was right here. I just gave a talk. He gave a talk here just before he passed away. Pat Giannetti, we call him.
Mm-hmm.
And so glad to be able to have this picture to show him.
Yes.
And also, I'm going to talk a little bit about sports in town.
Mm-hmm.
On Brooksby Road, before all those houses were built on Brooksby Road, off Great Road,
mm-hmm.
we had there a football team.
A football
Bedford
team.
They had a semi-pro football team. I guess the civic club bought the uniform from. I would go down there on a Sunday to watch a football game off Brooksby Road.
Wow.
My little bicycle.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Uh-huh. Let's put this out.
This is quite interesting. It's a clipping from a Bedford paper. It's 1888. Prohibition.
A town redeemed, the temperance history of Bedford, Mass, from rum rule to freedom. Bedford certainly had its quarrels over drinking and temperance
in
town.
It was at the Bedford House, the hotel I just showed you.
Yes.
They had a bar downstairs.
They had a bar, uh-huh.
Yeah.
Yes.
And I would go to that Bedford House years ago where the Grange had it, and silent movies upstairs. I think it was 10 cents to see a movie.
Oh, that must have been a lot of fun for you.
That's right.
Did they have somebody play the piano while the movie was on?
Mrs. Blake played Iowa Blake played the piano during the movie. I do remember that well.
Oh.
Yeah.
I've heard her name as and seen photographs of her playing the piano. Yeah, I think she did a lot of that for a lot of events.
This is a photograph I have. It's Hanscom Field. It shows the hangars right here. And up on top of the hill is before Raytheon was there, but that's where Raytheon was. So
the hill there where Raytheon is now.
Yeah,
and things looked pretty simple back then. There's sort of a bare hillside some small planes.
This is from inside the hangar.
Looking from inside the hangar.
And they helped develop radar there during World War II, which is a great asset we had.
Yes.
And I'm going to show a picture of my dad's garage. My dad came to Bedford. Getting the Ford agency. He started the Ford agency with $6,000 and he was a full-time Ford dealer.
It says, Bedford Motor Sales, your authorized Ford dealer, 170 Great Road.
That's 1957.
1957. Oh, here are these cars the big tail fins.
Those cars are very collectible today.
Yes, indeed. Don't you wish you had several of them in the backyard?
This garage is where the Sunoco station is today, and also it's right behind it on the Bedford Shopping Center.
Yes, the Bedford Shopping Center. That was the site where your late in-laws had their big farm.
That's right. Yeah.
Yes, yeah. It's funny they're selling farm products there now with Whole Foods.
Then I probably jump around too much, but I have some photographs that were given to me years ago. Some lady had taken photographs of the 1938 hurricane. Mm-hmm. So you can see there's a barn on Great Road that was knocked down.
Yes, it's torn away from the rest of the building. The barn is upside down.
Yeah, it really made a mess of it.
It created great havoc all over New England, and aren't we lucky? Nobody in Bedford died.
I think there's over 500 people killed in the 1938 hurricane, especially on the South Shore, Long Island.
Yeah, people didn't know it was coming. Yeah.
This is a house that's on Great Road and Brixby Road. We call it the Loomis House.
Oh, yes.
That took a beating. You see all the trees have been down.
Torn up. Yeah, lots of thousands of trees felled, lots of buildings damaged.
We put these down here so I have to go through them.
Certainly, we can put them down there.
I'm jumping around like crazy here, but this is my late father-in-law.
My nephew.
This is taken where the Bedford Shopping Center is, too. You see the fields behind the horses? All fields went out to Page Road.
And what was your father-in-law's name?
Sefton.
Yeah.
Henry Sefton.
Henry Sefton.
And they sold the farm for $17,000.
Oh, my goodness.
I think it was 75 acres of land.
And then he and his wife came over from Switzerland?
Switzerland, yeah. They were Swiss, yeah.
The Swiss family Sefton here in Bedford?
Yeah.
And who are all these charming young people in this?
Well, I'll start out with the school.
Schools.
This is they called it the junior high school. It's from the 5th grade to the 9th grade, and we had a cafeteria, and I do remember it, and also right next to the principal's office was a school dentist.
Mm-hmm.
Dr. Flavin came over from Concord one day a week and do work in filling teeth and extracting teeth and so forth.
Once a week?
The filling cost 25 cents to have filling in it. Mm-hmm. Extraction was 50 cents.
Mm-hmm.
And we did an old-fashioned foot drill.
Uh-huh.
Didn't even have an electric drill. Boy, it did hurt.
So they had the dental clinic there in the school because there weren't any dentists at Bedford at the time, were there?
That's right.
I'm sure the parents were very happy to have that, and I'm sure the kids all hated it, right?
Sure did.
No fun going to the
around looking for the door. Every kid would be so scared to go to the dentist.
There wasn't a whole lot of pain control then.
Now you see right here in the front steps of the schoolhouse is the picture of my class.
Uh-huh.
This is my class from the first grade to ninth grade.
This is in 1939, and there you are in the top row, the third one in. That's
and these
young John.
Three boys were killed in World War II. Out of the percentage, very high. It's Ralph Hume, George Vetterman, and John Ross. They were all killed in World War II, unfortunately.
It's wonderful you have this photo.
Yeah.
And all the girls seem to be in almost all in print dresses, floral prints.
Yeah,
that was the big fashion, I guess, in 1939.
Yeah.
So, but the junior high is what we're now using as town hall.
This is another photograph of my dad's garage. Mm-hmm. And this is where the farmhouse was, right there, the Sefton farmhouse.
We can see the roof of it.
And this is Dad's Ford dealership right here, the Lincoln Zephyr. There's the two mechanics right here and so forth.
So this is how you got started in working with cars, right?
Yeah, that's
you were,
right,
as
yeah.
a young
my
man.
My hobby was restoring antique cars. Someday I'm going to talk about my antique cars I had.
Yeah. What was the first one you ever had? What was the first car?
1911 Ford Roadster. Bought it for $15. my brother and I painted it, got running, got tires for it. Didn't really restore it. But I used to drive all around town with it. 1911 Torpedo Roadster Ford. Yeah.
You were a motorhead from an early age.
This is a sketch done by Charles O'Dowd. He lived in town. He had a nice old man, older man, and his son was a friend of mine. And that's the old Bedford Junction railroad station right there.
Yeah, the railroad station.
And that's what we call the Coleman Grand, which is now the bike shop over there. And this is Railroad Avenue out here. And up there is South Street.
Yes. So and this was made from life back then.
He probably did it on sketching. This is the, we always call it a roundhouse. Actually, it was not a roundhouse, but it was a place where the trains coming from Boston Main Railroad, to come to Bedford. And they would keep the steam going all night long. And this is where they turned the trains around so they could go back to Boston the next day. And this little, you never believe what that is. That's an outhouse. And it's an outhouse over Elm Brook. So we went swimming. We made sure we swam on this side of the river and rather than the other side of the river. You know why?
That's why.
It was an outhouse on the bridge.
Yes,
not very sanitary, but.
No, it was a flush toilet, courtesy of Elm Brook.
This is quite an interesting photograph I have. It's the 1929 anniversary of Bedford being 300 years old. Or was it 250? I'm not sure, maybe it was 250. This is a complete police department. Chief Sullivan, Matty McMahon, as a state trooper. And there's the Bedford House over there.
The hotel. So we're looking at the Great Road,
and
this is the Bicentennial Parade in 1929. And the town common is over here. You just see a corner of it on the left.
That's a complete fire police department. Right
all
there.
Two of them. Yeah. That's the whole department.
And this is a 1928 Model A Ford. That was the first police cruiser.
Oh, was it?
Yeah.
And behind are three men on horseback.
Yeah, out of the parade.
Out of the parade, and the whole town turned out.
Yeah.
And speaking of automobiles, what's this one?
Yeah, Dad was a Legionnaire. My dad was in naval aviation, World War One.
So
he
was
quite interesting. So anyway, the National Convention of the Legion was in Boston, 1929.
The American
so
Legion.
Post 221. American Legion Bedford made a car for the parade, and this is what they made.
So
we called it Leopolina.
Yeah. So your father attached some more on the back, didn't he?
He cut the shut down the wheelbase. So you go down the road, you give it the gas, the two front wheels would go up in the air.
Yeah. You had the guy sitting way in the back, and if they all leaned back, it helped. Yes.
You could lock one of the wheels, and the car was up in the air. It would go around in circles too in a big area. We built another one for the Legion Convention in Boston after World War II. So Dad had built another one. It's like that one.
That's a treasure. And the American Legion 221 is still in business here in Bedford, still active.
Here's
another old car.
This is Dad's showroom from the Ford dealership. It's a 1926. Did you see the cost of the car?
$374, brand new, delivered.
That's in the showroom. My mother put a fern here to make it look a little prettier. And this is the parts department right back here.
Shelves with all the parts on, and it looks like a one bay or two bays. Oh, here are the doors,
The
entrance doors.
Here, you can push it closer. That's the showroom. Here's the same showroom in 1937. Fit in 1957. There's a brand new Ford right there in the showroom. Dad wanted cash for all the services. He
all
the
repairs, cash.
Yeah.
No messing around.
Okay. Now here's the same car again.
Oh, showing how they tipped it up.
Yeah,
so a policeman there is pretending to give him a ticket.
That's right. This Harry Schneider, Dick Gilman, Hosey Hammett, they're all old Bedford people. This is a state trooper. Looks like he's writing a ticket to him.
Dated 1929, so this was the for the Bedford Bicentennial celebration.
Yeah. I'm glad my mind is still pretty good to be able to relate to all these old things.
We're delighted that your mind is able to relate all these old things.
You know, they just turned 90 a little while ago, and my mind is still good, so I'm glad I can do this.
Well, we are so delighted that you're doing it, John.
This is the Joe Blaine house, or we used to call Mr. Dutton lived there.
Yeah, the Dutton family were living there.
I talked about Mr. Dutton the other day, about the farms he had and so forth, but they were a nice couple.
Yeah, Warren Dutton and his wife.
There's another one of that sketch I did of the...
an enlargement, yes. The sketch of the Bedford Depot and the freight house.
Yeah.
And railroad tracks.
Then here is a very, very rare deed.
Ooh.
It's dated.
That antique handwriting?
Dated. Will you believe the date on it? It's 1719. Mm-hmm. And that, it says Concord. That was before Bedford was formed.
Mm-hmm.
Bedford was formed in 1929.
From part of Concord?
1729, part of Concord and Billerica.
Yeah, well, I see one of the signatures that says Hannah Hartwell.
Yeah. Now, I take this, you have to handle it very carefully. And then I'm going to do a little joke, because this is a color Xerox. And I tell people it's so very rare, I go like that. They almost faint. That's just a color Xerox of it.
Yes. It sure looks like the real thing, all that wonderful handwriting.
Now, here's the Union School. This was built.
This is now the town center, but it started out as the Union School, because it united all the schools in one instead of having them all over town.
From the first grade to the fourth grade. The fifth grade was in the new brick building they just finished.
Mm-hmm.
And now you know my story about liking the second grade so well, I stayed there 2 years. And I was very, very sick from scarlet fever.
That's
when the building was new.
So you had scarlet fever, and here you still are going strong at 90.
Yeah, who knows?
You have a tough constitution, John.
Well,
that's a very wonderful photo.
And I'm going to talk a little bit about the fire department. And the fire department was all volunteer fire department until 1950. But before that, it was all volunteer fire department. It was a little wooden building on Elm Street, behind the common. And during World War II, the start of World War II, there was the air raid center also.
Oh, I hadn't heard
and
that.
And upstairs they had a big pool table for the firemen could play pool between fires. But they were called men, though. But they would meet every Wednesday, the fire department, and practice putting out fires and pumping water and so forth like that.
Mm-hmm.
And Dad was fire chief from 1939 to 1956, volunteer fire chief. You got paid $50 a year. When I was living home with my dad, I would go to a lot of the fires and watch, take care of the old firemen. They were pretty old. They were out there still fighting fire.
Mm-hmm.
And we had a lot of forest fires years ago in Bedford, too.
Yes.
Yeah, and there were a lot of those chimney fires because people were burning wood and coal.
Oh.
So those were big fires years ago. There were a lot more house fires then than there is today. Yeah.
Because people had open flames, they were using fires. Yeah, and then there were barn fires, too.
Yeah.
Which could be pretty spectacular when they went up.
Yeah, and then I can relate a little bit about 1943. I got a letter in the mail.
Mm-hmm.
You have been selected to report to Concord. I was drafted. So February 1, Dad drove me over to Concord and went through the physical, then on the train to go to Fort Devens. And so I had my basic training in Texas, but I was inducted up at Fort Devens.
Mm-hmm.
Camp Devens.
First you had to report over to the Concord Armory.
So
from the day you got your notice, how much time did you have before you had to report? Did they give you
a week?
1 week.
Yeah, get ready. Yeah.
Did you? Yeah. Perhaps at that point you were sort of had the idea you might be drafted, didn't you?
I was with General Patton in World War II. I think I've talked about being in the service before, so I will repeat my story again. World War II,
I
was one of the lucky ones that came home.
Very lucky, yes. You went to both Europe and Japan.
That's right, yeah.
So you got to see some of the world. This Bedford boy came back to Bedford after seeing so much.
And then I told before about moving the hogs all over the town. They had to count the hogs to see how many. I was during the Depression. Mm-hmm. They would take an inventory of the hogs, and they'd move them around towns because they would get paid so much for not growing so many hogs. You'd get better prices.
Yeah, the federal government was subsidizing farms to cut back on the number of hogs, so they would just hide them. That's pretty clever.
So anything else? I guess that's...
Well, here it is winter time, and we're doing winter sports as best we can.
Well,
what
yes,
can
winter sports is...
That's
right. I'm glad you brought that up. What we used to do was go skiing all over town in different places. Mm-hmm. And our skis weren't, in those days, weren't very good. We just plain maple skis with no steel edges, and the bindings were not that good. But we went skiing on... My favorite place to ski was Shady Hill. Mm-hmm. Not many people know about Shady Hill. That's on Howell Avenue towards the
air base.
Air base, and it's just a wonderful, wonderful experience. And I also witnessed the first airplane land at Hanscom Field.
You did.
It was in before World War II. It was a C-47, and it circled the town. And all of the town knew something was going on. Mm-hmm. It landed on Hanscom Field. And I went down on my bicycle to see it like yesterday. Yeah.
Oh, lucky you.
Yeah, lucky you.
Yeah. Did you ever ski over at the Little Ski Area on Old Billerica Road?
I skied at Paul Little Ski Toe. They had a ski toe there. Yeah.
What a hoot to think of that hill there.
He built a golf course at a ski toe there. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And like I said, why there was so much traffic going through town, there's no Route 3. So.
Yes.
The route, I can remember Middlesex Turnpike was all the dirt road.
Really? Wow.
Yeah. I actually called it a turnpike because it ran for people to go across the Concord River, too. Mm-hmm. There was a place where they could cross the Concord River all the way to the end of the turnpike. Mm-hmm. It started in Allington. It was a one straight road. Yeah. The Burlington Mall is now as part of the Turnpike. Yeah.
The old Middlesex Turnpike. What about skating? People used to skate on the Concord River, didn't they?
Skating on the Concord River, we had to make sure it was safe enough. But the big place to go skating was Bedford Springs. And
uh-huh.
One time the town was plowing the snow off so we could play hockey up there. The truck went through the ice.
Oh, no.
But Bedford Springs was never, the water's no more than 4 or 5 feet deep. So this, it was easy. They had to tow the truck out, drain out the gas tank, and change the oil and all those things. It was just they saved the truck.
Good, yes, it didn't have very far to go, but still, that's a fine howdy do. Yeah. Did you ever play hockey yourself? Were you a hockey
player? We used to play
player?
Street hockey too. Mm-hmm. That was put a couple of rocks on them, play with a hockey stick on play in the street. But we also played hockey. Mm-hmm. And I also played hooky, too.
Hooky.
I did that when I was in high school.
And what did you like to do when
I went to Boston playing? One day. And I won't tell you what we went. We went to the old Howard. You don't know about the old Howard,
do you? That was a theater, was it?
It was a casino.
Casino.
Burlesque dances.
Oh, John.
I'm off the subject matter about growing up in town.
That's
fine.
Did you take the train to get to Boston?
We took the bus to Boston.
The bus
and trolley cars. Mm-hmm. You'd take the trolley bus to Arlington Heights, and then there'd be a trolley car would take you to Harvard Square. Mm-hmm. Then you'd get on the L-Wife also and go to Boston on the subway. Yeah.
Do you recall how much it cost you to go?
I don't remember what the cost was. Wasn't much.
Yeah, not a whole lot compared to today's prices.
Yeah.
What about sledding in Bedford?
The place where we go sledding was the best place was on Pine Hill Road. And I remember Pine Hill Road, you couldn't drive a car through there. And they eventually fixed up the road and so forth. But it was a great place to go sledding.
So that's where the water towers are now. You could sled on that hill.
Good sized hill, and we would coast down the hill.
Because it's all forest now, but back then it wasn't.
All open fields and
all open.
Flexible flyer was good. Yeah, mm-hmm. And what happened is during the Depression, my dad bought me skates. He always thought I'd buy them a little bit bigger because I could wear them for a little bit longer.
Yeah,
and I always leaned over. The skates never really did fit me because they were too big.
They left you room to grow, but a little too much.
Yes.
Did you do any tobogganing? Did you know anybody who owned a toboggan?
Well, I think I told the story. My brother and I restored a toboggan, mm-hmm. and we varnished it and got it all waxed up and fixed a cushion and so forth. Mm-hmm. And we call it McGovern's Hill. And some of the McGoverns lived up there with a farmhouse.
That's off Hartwell Road.
It was a good size hill. And mm-hmm. first time down the hill, we hit a tree, broke it right in half, the toboggan. Luckily, we didn't break our necks. We were okay. We didn't get hurt.
After all that work and money you put into restoring that toboggan, the first run.
But we knew the places to go skiing in town and also skating and so forth. We used to have snowball fights. I don't know if the kids have snowball fights anymore.
I think sometimes we would build
like a fort out of snow and sort of throw snowballs at the other kids.
Yes, because kids played outdoors, right?
You were outdoors
a lot, sounds like, winter and summer.
Brick building, which is now the town center, they had no basketball place. We couldn't play basketball. We had a basketball court outside the school. Mm-hmm. There in the parking lot is now, and we played basketball. But Bedford never excelled in basketball. Did I tell you about the dentist? I did mention the dentist, didn't I? Yeah.
The dinners? What dinners was that?
The dentist.
The dentist. Yeah. Oh, yes, yes,
yeah,
in the school
the
there.
So
terrifying.
Yeah.
I recall how much I didn't like to go to the dentist, but it wasn't right there threatening me every day.
Yeah. But, I'm trying to add humor to mm-hmm. being a town historian. I got a lot of real funny stories. I guess I've told most of the funny stories. Yeah.
You have a good supply of them and
good supply
for
of
a long time in Bedford's history.
And one thing I didn't mention is the Barons, root spots. They changed the name to Baron. Mm-hmm. They were farmers way down where the Air Force is today. And they were brought over, the Baron root spots came to this country to help train horses. We had a racetrack here in town.
At the Parker Farm on Old Billerica Road, yes.
Yeah, and they would train the horses. And you remember that you told me the other day the name of the horse that won the world's record.
Yes, it was a horse that was foaled on the Parker Farm. I think it was Uhlan, U-H-L-A-N, and it set a trotting record that it was unbroken for 24 years.
Yeah,
so it was a very famous horse.
Yeah.
So we have not only famous people and good people, we have a famous horse and born in Bedford. Yes. What about summer sports? When all the snow and ice went away, what were you doing for fun?
Well, you didn't have anything really organized for the summer sports. There was no little league or things like that. We played on our own. We played scrub baseball. Mm-hmm. You know, your name was on a bat, see where you're going to be a hitter, mm-hmm. and so forth. I was never a great ball player, but we did have a very, very outstanding football player here in Bedford, mm-hmm. and that was John Yarkos.
John Yarkos, there
were farmers over there, they were Polish. Mm-hmm. And John Yarkos was weighed about 280 pounds, very, very big, played guard for Boston College, and he played also in the Sugar Bowl, and Boston College went to. Yeah.
Yes, I think I've seen newspaper clippings about him.
I mentioned
him,
how I met him in Europe during the war ended.
How was that?
Well, I guess I mentioned it, but when the war ended, I had a pass to go to Paris for the day. Mm-hmm. And I looked for someone named Bob Primman, who was in the Signal Corps, I knew.
So Bob Primman.
And I saw a patch of a Signal Corps soldier. I said, I'm looking for Bob Primman. He's in the Signal Corps. He's in my outfit. So 10 minutes there was Bob Primman. Mm-hmm. So we talking, he said, I'll call up Chico Palmieri. Well, Chico Palmieri was also in Paris, but Chico had a Jeep. Mm-hmm. So I had a tour of Paris in the Jeep.
So you found two other guys from Bedford who were there.
And then I also
went
to see John Yarkos, who was in the naval, he was in charge of all the inland ships and boats for the Navy in Europe. Mm-hmm. During World War II. Yeah.
Wow,
yeah,
what a coincidence. You were able to find these guys amongst all the soldiers who were in Paris at the time. You found some Bedford guys.
Yeah.
That's wonderful.
That's wonderful. I should be about 130 years old with the things I've done in my life.
You have led a very active life. Between being in the military.
The only thing I ever got A in schools was art. I was not a good scholar. It was not college material, but I was encouraged to go to art school in the sixth grade by Mrs. Lilligren. I really loved that teacher. She was the most wonderful teacher. They named the road after her here in Bedford.
Yes.
Mrs. Lilligren Way. Yeah.
Yes, it's over by behind the high school there.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yes.
We played croquet. We played marbles. And I guess I'm trying to think of the man's Mr. Harrington, Mr. Man named Harrington. was a great guy. I keep using that all the time, but he was a great guy. Mm-hmm. We'd go to Boston once, he'd invite bags and bags of glassy marbles and go up to the Bedford Common and throw them for the kids. And all the kids in those days played marbles, which kids don't do today. There's a lot of little activities we did. We made our games. Mm-hmm. We played hide-and-go-seek, and girls played hopscotch and things like that.
And jump rope, I'm sure.
Jump rope and activities. And,
so you were a very energetic, busy little boy out there, weren't you?
I was always
on the go, it sounds like.
Going
always
all the time,
doing something, and then you got to be fixing cars and doing your artwork, and
I've been very fortunate. I was able to do artwork all over the world for my, what I do is I hand-colored prints. Someday I'll show my collection up here.
That would be great, yes. Well, some of them are on display.
I did watercolor painting, but I did learn a great deal working for Raytheon for 7 years as an illustrator. Mm-hmm. And they gave me a wonderful idea about resin-coated photographic paper. But I'll get back someday and talk about my art career.
That would be great. We'd love to see that.
Make a living doing that for many, many years.
And a number of your works are in the buildings in town here. If anybody sees an old print that's been colored by hand, take a look in the corner and see if it says Joan Dodge. Also a whole bunch of your works are up at the, what's the hotel called now? It's the Doubletree Hotel. I always have to remember what the name is. Yeah. In the hallways, those are your works, part of your business. So
Waldorf Astoria in New York City.
They've got some of your works hanging there in the Waldorf Astoria itself and all
so
over I'll the
world.
So I'll
talk again about someday about my art career.
Okay. Well, we're running out of time today, so maybe we'll draw it to a close for now, but we'll love to have you back and talk about some of your art.
I'm glad to share these things I remember, and there's 10,000 more things I will bring up sometime.
Love to have you come and do that, John. Yeah. You can come anytime and tell us some more of your Bedford memories.
Yeah.
So I'll say thank you.
This living history, I think, is wonderful for not just kind of knowing it, but after I'm gone, they can look back and say, look at that old fool.
They'll say, our wonderful town historian. Yeah. So thank you, John, and thank you
all
for coming back.
My pleasure.